My name is August Nils. I'm co-coordinator of the Minnesota-Cuba Committee, which I can proudly say has been in existence since 1990. And it's a real honor to be here and to have a conversation, which is what we intend this to be. And we have a real special treat, an unexpected treat, a real honor on our part to have with us one of Cuba's foremost intellectuals, writers, a leader of the Union of Artists and Writers in Cuba, UNIAC, and a member, if I'm not mistaken, of the Central Committee of the Cuban Communist Party. So this is a real, real special honor to have Miguel Barnet with us. And his compañera, Yanela, who is with the with ECAP. And so I think what we're going to do is to improvise here a little bit today. And I will give a few introductory remarks about the topic, and then turn it over to Miguel, who will read comments. He's prepared comments he will read. And then I think we want to open it up for discussion. The main thing is to have the feedback with you for this topic. The panel is entitled Race in Cuba, An Introduction, recognizing that we really cannot do justice to this topic. And all we hope to do is to pique your interest, suggest some things that you can read to find out more about the topic. What I want to say is first, this topic, I think, like any topic in Cuba, has to be approached in a way that takes into account context. Context is crucial, both historical context and geographical context. And it's my view that you really cannot make sense of the Cuban experience unless you put the Cuban experience in both global and historical context. And to treat Cuba's reality without taking into the context is to be nearsighted, not to really understand Cuba's reality. And a part of that claim, a part of the suggestion I'm making is that we have to be very careful in making judgments about Cuba on this particular topic if we're only looking at coming at it from the perspective of the U.S. experience. If we're coming at it from the perspective of the U.S. experience. It's my contention in many ways the United States is more the exception to the rule when it comes to the Americas on the question of race. The U.S. more the exception to the rule for a particular set of historical circumstances, which we can talk about during the discussion. It was a comment that Karl Marx made in 1852 in his analysis of the failed French Revolution of 1848 and 1849, mm-hmm. called the 18th Brumaire of Karl Marx. And Marx took up this question, this old age debate about free will versus determinism. And Marx said, yes, we all have free will. Humans have free will. But we don't get a chance to choose the circumstances under which we make decisions. That's what we don't get a chance to choose. And the race question, like other questions in Cuba, have to be put into the context of the circumstances in which the Cuban Revolution found itself. Cuba was a slave society. Slavery was in Cuba up until 1886, officially. It lasted longer than it was in the U.S. And developments in the U.S. had a big impact on the future of slavery. The overthrow of slavery in 1865 had a major, major impact for the future of slavery within Cuba. And Cuba was also a very underdeveloped society, underdevelopment, exploitation, and so on. And this is the background, this is the luggage, this is the baggage of the past. This is the baggage of the past that the revolution found itself in 1959. As a part of that history, unlike the United States, there had been no mass Freedom Now or civil rights movement in Cuba. That had not been a part of Cuba's reality. It's my view that the coming U.S. revolution will stand on the shoulders, be able to stand on the shoulders of the social movements, including the Freedom Now movement. You notice I'm calling it the Freedom Now movement. I prefer, that's what it called. No one called it the civil rights movement. It was really the Freedom Now movement. Well, that didn't exist within Cuba. And so in 1959, the Cuban Revolution found itself having to carry out tasks that had not been carried out prior to 1959. And tremendous changes began to be made with the revolution. And those changes had an enormous impact not only within Cuba, but also internationally. That is, the changes that took place within Cuba around the question of race had enormous implications internationally. But people of African origin made tremendous gains within Cuba. And those gains lasted in many ways until Cuba entered into a major economic crisis. The collapse of the Cuban economy during the special period. And the collapse of the Cuban economy had consequences for people of African origin within Cuba. And I can't prove it, but I've always been of the opinion that when the Clinton administration decided in 1993 to allow Cubans who had relatives in the United States to send more money to their relatives in Cuba. I can't prove this, but I'm convinced the Clinton administration did that in order to be able to create a breach within Cuban society. Those who had access to remittances and those who didn't have access to remittances. And we began to see inequalities beginning to develop in the 1990s. And this is when the leadership led by Fidel Castro began to draw attention to this at the urging of other people who were in UNIAC that Miguel has worked with over the years, taking initiatives around the race question. Those of us who had the privilege to hear Comandante Fidel Castro when he spoke here in New York in September of 2008 at Riverside Chapel, heard him say the following. I am not claiming that our country is a perfect model of equality and justice. It was some time before we discovered that marginality and racial discrimination with it are not something that one gets rid of with a law or even with 10 laws. And we have not managed to eliminate them completely in 40 years, unquote. I encourage you to read, if you haven't, the great interviews with Comandante Fidel, Cien Horas in Spanish, or My Life, the interviews with the French journalist Ignacio Romanet, and those three or four pages on the race question which is an elaboration in many ways on what I've reported on the speech that Comandante gave in 2000. So it was out of those discussions, and I had the good fortune to work with one of the people who was a part of those discussions, Esteban Morales Dominguez, retired professor at the University of Havana, had the privilege of helping to translate his essays, and we published in a little book called Race in Cuba. And it documented the discussion that was underway from about 2000 to about 2010. And those discussions have continued within Cuba. And so I will let this serve as a kind of an introduction for what Miguel has to say, and then we can come back and open it up for discussion for other people.
Okay. Thank you. Do you think I need a microphone?
You may.
Yeah. Maybe not.
Okay.
Yes, I need a microphone.
It doesn't. Oh, this one is not the. This is for recording. Yeah, you have to.
Okay.
Okay.
You can get my voice from here? No. Well, dear friends, colleagues, thanks for coming. Huh? According to my age, I cannot do this standing up any longer. I am not young anymore.
No problem.
So, when you're 77 and you have two hernias in the lower back, you better sit down. I know I'm not old, I'm just getting old. No, thanks a lot for coming, all of you, basically, especially the Cuban ambassador to the UN and all her team, which are... Technology knew that I was here, that I was her enemy. Okay. Thanks to all of you for being here. Thanks to Dr. August Nimtz. I think after all the comments he made, I should just ask you to bring up questions, because my comments and my considerations in this field of racial issues are very similar to what he just said. Of course, the first thing is that we have to establish big differences between the situation of race in Cuba and the situation, the historical situation of race in the United States. That's basic, to understand what is going on here and what is going on there. Some people are, in Cuba, confused when they try to establish the same schemes, the same society that was created here, and then that's a big mistake, because then what happens is that we really get stuck, we don't progress, because our history is different. As Dr. August Nimtz said, we come from a slave society. Slavery was abolished in Cuba very, very close, and first in the United States and in Cuba in 1886. The last slave ship that came to Cuba was in 1883 with a stock of about 300 slaves. Imagine, this is just very, very close in terms of historical perspective. Well, this paper, I brought the paper in Spanish and in English, but I think I better read it in English because I heard that first there's no translator here, and on the other hand, some of you don't speak Spanish, so I'll do my best. I have to thank my dear friend Peggy Gilpin, who is here, because she helped me in the translation of this paper some time ago. First of all, I have to admit that these are general considerations about the issue of race. The issue of race is a very complex social issue, but in Cuba it has its own nuances, its own differences. And I want to begin by synthesizing the state of the discussion about race in Cuba, and to that end I will endeavor to answer the following questions myself. What identified elements need to be taken into consideration to evaluate the impact of policies intended to eradicate racial discrimination starting from the triumph of the revolution in 1959 to today? What are the main achievements and shortcomings in the implementation of this policy? What objective and subjective factors have a bearing on the development of racial problems in Cuba, specifically with respect to the population of African origin, both nationally and internationally? What are the differences in perception among various segments of the Cuban population? How are the problems of racial discrimination that are still extant in Cuba being confronted? This analysis of racial issues and discrimination based on skin color is not definite, although we chose to pose questions intended to focus more clearly on this complex problem. The initial approaches are centered on methodological aspects, criteria to evaluate policies, analysis of objectives, achievements, and shortcomings, with the aim of endowing this interpretation with objectivity. From the triumph of the revolution, the impact of Cuban policy intended to eradicate racial discrimination may be evaluated from diverse perspectives that run the gamut from indulgence and inertia to confrontation or out-and-out criticism. This implies that we should devote attention to the establishment of those elements which allow a balanced assessment of this policy. In other words, to avoid the prejudices for or against during half a century with a broad legal foundation has meant overcoming racial problems in Cuba. There are those who consider that any pattern of conduct or legal rule is a worthless bit of paper before the sea of inequalities that may destroy people whose physical color they identify with a historic burden which originated with slavery and is today anchored in poverty. In my opinion, the factors that must be taken into account to undertake a comprehensive and impartial evaluation of Cuba's racial policies between 1959 and today may be summarized in three groups. Governmental discourse, aimed at raising awareness and arranging in order of importance the values of equality among all human beings as the basis of Cuban society. Second, legal status, laws, instruments, and directives which oppose all racial discrimination and promote the exercise of full citizen access to education, health, culture, sports, and social security, among others. Third, an economic practice, where the capacity of the productive forces have not satisfied the demands of employment, consumption, investment, accumulation, and so on and so on. The resulting negative effects for the Cuban population were intensified in stages like that of the so-called special period. You all know what the special period was in the 90s, right? There are effects that should be followed with special consideration in population groups with inherited disadvantages resulting from a greater poverty and marginalization due to place of origin, country or city, blacks and white, sex, women, men, to occupational sector and age, among others. Dr. Nimtz already spoke about the remittances in Cuba. Of course, you all know that most of the remittances reach the white population, and the black population hardly received any remittances, very few, for reasons that are historical. Having to do with governmental discourse, the first point, the strategy developed by the leader of the revolution, Fidel Castro, takes first place as a vital factor in the process of endowing the most needy in the population with self-respect, particularly after the overthrow of the pseudo-republican dictatorship, during which being black, poor, or a woman meant lower educational and cultural levels and poorer health care. Fidel, in defense of these elements, said, and I am quoting Fidel now, "The problem of racial discrimination is, unfortunately, one of the most complex and difficult that the revolution has to approach. The problem of social discrimination is not the problem of the rent, of expensive drugs. It is not the problem of the telephone company and not even that of Latifundia, which is one of the serious problems we have to face." And I ask myself, said Fidel, what is the difference between one injustice and another injustice? What difference there is between a peasant with no land and a person who is not given the chance to work? Doesn't a black who does not work starve to death just as a peasant with no land does? And why must the revolution be compelled to solve other injustices and not to solve this one? I finished the quotation of Fidel. Around the hurricane transforming Cuban reality, a strong synergy of ideas and actions joined together between the political leadership and society, favoring growing equality between men and women, blacks and whites, workers and peasants, and thus creating a process of broad, popular, and intellectual scope. It was necessary to study the life and work of advanced thinkers to understand the roots and expression which characterized the evolution of this subject. Three of the most important thinkers to be studied are Fernando Ortiz, the Cuban most prominent anthropologist, José Luciano Franco, historian, and Nicolás Guillén, the black national poet who was the first president of the Writers and Artists Organization, in the fields of anthropology, history, and literature. Without blacks, Cuba would not be Cuba, sententiously declared Fernando Ortiz with the same scientific and humanistic sharpness with which he said, I quote, "It would be trivial and erroneous to study human factors in Cuba by races. Apart from the fact that many racial categories are conventional and indefinable, we must acknowledge their actual insignificance to understand Cubanness, which is nothing but a category of culture. To understand the Cuban soul, it is not races that should be studied, but cultures. The contribution of blacks to Cubanness has not been scant. Apart from their immense labor force, which made the economic entry of Cuba in world civilization possible, and besides their liberating pugnacity, which cleared the advent of the independence, their cultural influence can be noticed in the food, the cuisine, the vocabulary, but especially in three expressions of Cubanness: art, religion, and the tone of collective emotive nature." Finished quotation. As to the legal status, the institutionalization of a new political and socioeconomic order in the country during the revolution gave undeniable backing to social conquests, a system of laws, codes, and regulations whose highest expression is the Constitution of the Republic of Cuba, condemned every expression of racism and guaranteed the right of all citizens to education, health, culture, food, and social security. It is well to remember that the racial problem in Cuba, as in any other country, could not be solved through legal channels alone. The outcome depends on diverse elements such as educational level, group idiosyncrasies, and others. Therefore, more attention needs to be paid to how coercive legislation complements other actions which facilitate the full integration of all Cubans into the national project, regardless color of their skin. Compliance with every law requires equal attention to its letter and spirit and cannot be limited to a mechanical interpretation of its contents, a limitation that at times may work against better performance. We are aware that the existence of legislation against racial discrimination is not enough in itself to transform the habits and customs closely linked to daily life. It is necessary to explore other ways of achieving increased compatibility between the dynamics of national reality and the law, and a balance between what in legal parlance is established de jure and taken for granted de facto. As to the economic practice and its social repercussions, the situation of racism seems highlighted when the impact of Cuban state policy against racism is evaluated. Cases of elementary orthodoxy in which political criteria were directly extended to economic performance yielded negative results. For example, when access to employment, housing, and other options were implemented in an egalitarian manner without taking into account the diversity of conditions of the members of society. Liberal positions which exaggerate the moral excellence of some economic mechanisms have a negative effect. Taking these general factors into account, I will discuss a series of achievements and shortcomings of the policies intended to eradicate racial discrimination. Achievements. Helping human beings feel dignity is one of the largest achievements and an essential value in Cuban society during the period of the revolution that started in January 1959. The establishment of a system of guarantees for genuine access to all levels of national programs in education, health, culture, sport, and social security, among others, including something as complex as a stable food supply, especially for children from 0 to 14 years of age, in conditions of full equality for the entire Cuban population, the promotion of artistic and literary values with an African origin and emphasis of their contribution to Cuban cultural identity, the publication of books about Africa and of African literature and history with no comparison to the rest of Latin America. We have published more than 200 books of African writers, and we have also published books about Africa and African art or music or any other expression, and also novels and poems, more than any other country in Latin America, perhaps even more than in Brazil. We have the statistics. The strengthening of general and specialized systems of teaching throughout the country of national publication and support for the development of museums and music and dance groups, among other institutions, some world famous, such as the National Folkloric Dance Company, well, the African House, in the office of the city historian, the system of houses of culture, the Juan Marinello Institute, and the Fernando Ortiz Foundation, which I created in 1995. Gradually increasing respect for popular religions and worship of African origin at the highest levels, such as consideration of this topic at the Council of State acceptance of religious practitioners in the Cuban Communist Party. This began in the early 90s. And at the level of society, such things as inclusion of the theme in theaters and film programs and in visual arts exhibition halls. In contrast with what the mass media offers, we will return to this issue in the section of shortcomings. Working to overcome feelings and practices of racism in communities where respect usually prevails among neighbors on the basis of shared attitudes about family, study, work, compliance with rules, harmonically living side by side, participation in neighborhood tasks, although the high degree of subjectivity this implies makes it difficult to measure. And now the shortcomings. I try to be very objective and critical in this chapter, because we have done research, not me, but a group of investigators and writers in this field, and we have come to this conclusion. Shortcomings: insufficient practical implementation of the policies of the leadership intended to eradicate racial discrimination, especially by institutions whose systematic efforts in this area would complement the actions of the party and the state. This could be the case with national radio and TV, but for decades they have continued disseminating stereotypes of blacks and mulattoes, especially in soap operas and sitcoms, humoristic programs, where at times they are the object of negative appraisals or the butt of contemptuous jokes, thus exercising a strong negative impact on their large audience. The absence of a national agenda involving all the factors directly or indirectly linked to the development of social issues in present Cuban society. The U.S.-Cuba discrepancy has brought about domestic silence on questions that might undermine the unity of the people before their main foreign enemy. As time went by, its counterproductive effects have become visible, such as the weakening of domestic debate on topics of profound popular importance, such as race. We have overcome this, and we have created many institutions now, and even commissions fighting hard to put people to discuss and debate this in open fields. Low-profile debate of this topic in Cuba today regarding a national agenda. This frequently surfaces in conversations by the most dissimilar groups of youngsters, elders, workers, or intellectuals, but mostly with superficial expressions not dealing with the essence. From the methodological and conceptual points of view, this has hindered and hampered the implementation of a Cuban policy against racial discrimination during the last half century. Something deserving far-reaching consideration is the recent statement by the Cuban President Raúl Castro when talking about the, quote, the representativeness of the ethnic and gender composition of Cuban population in leadership positions. I personally consider, said Raúl, that the insufficient advance in this issue in 50 years of revolution is shameful. Quote, if we are incapable of offering a serious and objective analysis on scientific grounds and with multidisciplinary approaches to guarantee genuine and systematic impact against racial discrimination, we have not reached our goal. Awareness of the advances and limitations of the way racial topics have being dealt with within Cuba cannot only be attributed to the political leadership. It is increasingly necessary to widen the spectrum of analysis to other objective and subjective factors. This may prevent the emergence or survival of conceptions or expressions of racism and discrimination in our environment. The following aspects need to be taken into account. The idiosyncrasies of the Cuban people, still awaiting an updated sociological interpretation which would include human, geographical, historical, and economic factors. The racial composition of Cuban emigration, basically white during the revolutionary period, the different periods, taking into account the material contribution its members have offered their relatives in the island, especially in the conditions of that famous special period in the 90s after the fall of the socialist system in East Europe. On the other hand, internationalist actions by the Cuban Revolution, stressing the military aid and medical cooperation offered to the African peoples in a gesture of solidarity, with many professionals being trained in Cuba. The globalization of behaviors generated by the information society and the new technologies that increase the dynamics at an unprecedented pace in the exchange of knowledge, products, and services have created new social differentiations of every type and color. The development internationally projects like the slave route by UNESCO, created in 1993, which defends the identities derived from slavery through the promotion of knowledge and public awareness, as well as the designation of 2011 as the International Year of Afro Descendants by the United Nations General Assembly, among other world initiatives. I want to stress here that Cuba, in 1993, when the slave route was created in Africa, in the country of Benin, the city of Ouidah, which was one of the first cities that where the Africans were kidnapped by the Portuguese, Cuba had a very important role, and I myself was part of that, the creation of that program of UNESCO. And we are working very hard in Cuba to develop different programs within this program, and we have received congratulations from UNESCO for the work we have been doing in research and promotion of the Afro-Cuban expressions in general. Before we continue, I will dwell on an element that paradoxically is often overlooked: the level of racial integration our society has achieved, where the problem is not denouncing individual cases, but something more subtle, having to face more surreptitious discriminatory obstacles. This is the case of people who aspire to hold some given position in the sectors of tourism or joint ventures, or would like to play some given roles in TV and theater and have been prevented by the color of their skin. Now, the question of the different ways in which various segments in Cuban society view the racial issue should be answered in two parts. It would be unthinkable that this topic, in seen or perceived similarly by the various social segments in Cuba, as would happen in any other country. The acknowledgement that we are a people with diverse roots and identities, the fruit of a constant process of transculturation, is not equally understood by the many groups which make up the Cuban population, in some cases because of lack of education and in others because of denial. This gradation of perceptions has to do with human logic, which may produce a wide variety of reactions. In the specific case of race, the following trends can be identified. First, remaining feelings left by centuries of oppression under slavery and racial discrimination, with remnants of individual attitudes generated by the colonization and capitalization of our society. the shaping of an anti-racist social ethic, together with the consolidation of social justice in the revolutionary period, although racial discrimination has not been eradicated as illiteracy was. The integration of an intellectual vanguard that dignifies blacks and acknowledges the great contribution of cultures of African origin in Cuba, with exponents like Fernando Ortiz, José Luciano Franco, Lidia Cabrera, Nancy Morejón, Jesús Guanche, Natalia Bolívar, Rogelio Martínez Furé, Esteban Morales, among many other authors. A definition of the singular reaction to racial problems in present Cuba society, identified with the ignorance of them, may be defined with the words of this last researcher when he points, I'm talking about Esteban Morales, quote, "Still today, the greatest difficulty we come up against is making many understand that the problem exists. It is not difficult to realize that what is taught in schools about the racial question is very little, and in our scientific work, we barely take on the research of racial problems. Therefore, the conclusion is clear. It is not only that we have not confronted racism, but even worse, the prevailing thinking on race in Cuba today seems to be the same that liberals led in the 19th century." Finished quotation. Finally, I think that the solution to the still existing problems associated with racial discrimination in Cuba will emerge from a combination of two essential processes: the consistent analysis of the phenomenon and its intelligent confrontation. Only with this type of formulation, the essential and punctual aspects on this topic will be identified and may be examined from a global and comprehensive viewpoint that would keep us abreast with the challenges facing humankind in the 21st century. This is beginning to show in recent debates, in publications, as temas from the Ministry of Culture and Catauro, which is the journal that I am the director, from the Foundation Fernando Ortiz, which not only deals with African heritage, but also with Spanish heritage, and with topics of racism. In previous times, the black component in Cuban culture was dealt with superficially, a hidden and taboo topic. Throughout the Republican period, and few movies and plays that dealt with race, with the honorable exception of the poetry of Nicolas Guillén and the works of Wilfredo Lam, which offered a genuine view of our reality with all its nuances, acknowledging and projecting the essential values of the population of African origin in its full dimension within what is Cuban. Today, national institutions like the Institute Juan Marinello and the Fernando Ortiz Foundation work on topics of race in the context of our cultural identity with regular publications. In the case of the NGO bearing the name of the learned Cuban anthropologist, several numbers of the anthropological journal Catauro, the ethnographic map on the slave route in Cuba, as well as books that I could mention here. It's a long list. I will not mention the long list of books because I don't want to go into that because it's going to be very, very long. But books that are published by present authors, Cuban present authors, and also by authors from abroad that has offered great contributions to the footprints of African history and African legacy in my country. We cannot conclude this presentation about race in Cuban society today, following, as I said, the letter and spirit, a discourse and its voice, without understanding other important elements of behavior and ideas. First of all, we should recognize the growing role of community organizing as the cornerstone of the elimination of racism and social discrimination in Cuba through education, recreation, and other activities from the grassroots, aimed at individuals and the families in the streets and the neighborhoods. Because after all, This reconnects us to the original national idea of creating a free and equal nation. The dynamic idea emerging in Cuba about these problems and their multiple institutional and territorial ramifications urgently require a body of specialized knowledge about this topic as a specific area of the social sciences. This will contribute to an increasing understanding of procedures to be implemented in specific situations and will emphasize the importance of family and school in the shaping of values, together with political and patriotic education, as well as a technical and professional upgrading that will comprehensively and systematically contribute to overcome the present practice of racial issues in Cuban society. Part of the focus should be the sustained development of more democratic educational and research projects which pay attention to important topics in the national context, such as the so-called affirmative action programs developed in other countries and the one coined as Afro-descendants in the international level. To finish, allow me to repeat some words I heard from the main character of my book, The Autobiography of a Runaway Slave, Cimarrón. That black Cuban named Esteban Montejo, born in 1860 and interviewed by me in 1963 and 64, who in one of our first meetings confessed, "Because of being a runaway, I did not know my parents. I did not even saw them, but that is not sad, because it is true." This is a very stoic statement. Okay. I wrote something, some kind of a poem, with which I want to finish this presentation. When I went to the house of Gore slaves in Senegal, where thousands and thousands of slaves were kidnapped and sent to America, to Latin America. This is the poem. His last look before being laid out in the hold, his last look to the narrow door, to that island, to that land of his now sailing in the waves of lack of love towards unknown coasts. How much we want today those subs. The last traveling look, brutally uprooted from its landscape, from its home, from its banks. They were sold by their weight. We must pay the debt. There is still a long way to go. The future can not only be a hope, it has to be an achievement.
So what we want to do is now open the workshop up to Q&A and comments, and I'll ask you to be as brief as possible. It's 3:18, and we need to get out of here.
You should have asked me to be brief.
No.
I did my best because I had all my paper written in Spanish, so we had to do it in English.
Let me begin, though, by commenting on...
Yes.
Your book, your first book,
okay.
Biography of a Runaway Slave. I have long thought about the inspiration for the book, and he confirmed what I had guessed. There was a speech that Fidel Castro gave in June of 1961, about 2 months after the Playa Girón, the Bay of Pigs. And it's a very important speech. It's a very long speech. It's a speech in which Fidel talks about the tensions between the demands of a revolution and freedom of artistic expression. And in that speech, he talks about what the revolution has been able to do in terms of advancing culture. This question came up at this morning at the plenary about culture. And if you want to know about the revolution and culture, I think that speech that Fidel gives on the the question of culture, artists, freedom of expression is excellent place to begin. Near the end of the speech, Fidel talks about the kinds of stories in Cuba society that haven't been written. And he talked about men and women who had once been slaves. And we need to know their stories. And Miguel had confirmed today, he was sitting there and heard that speech, and that was the inspiration for his decision to do biography of a runaway slave. So he was a little modest about, but that was one of the first books in the Cuban Revolution that was a product of exactly the suggestion that Fidel had raised about the importance of telling these stories. All right, so let me open it up and hear from you, and here and then here. Yes. And if you could speak loud so everyone...
You can hear me, right?
Yeah.
I didn't think that'd be a problem.
Okay. I wanted to thank you all for having the panel, the discussion. You know, I really appreciate it. My name is Thomas. I'm from Texas, as Marvin said.
Speak up.
As Marvin said, I'm new from Texas. So I think, you know, as a person who studied in African-American studies, as a person who has studied and have equivalent of a bachelor's in African-American studies and a 65-year-old black man born in the South, that is one of the most in-depth presentations on the discussion of race that I've heard. You know, I really thought it was significant. Oftentimes in America, we talk about having this conversation about race, and I don't participate in those conversations because everybody doesn't have an opinion about my life. I think those kind of objective findings and that kind of analysis and approaches is the kind of discussion that James Baldwin does. Yeah. So I really appreciate it and just want to thank you for that.
Thank you. Thank you. And then here, and then in the back. Yeah.
My name is Alejandro. I'm from the Cuban mission staff. Thinking on the book by Miguel, The Runaway Slave, I was listening to him and at the same time remember something said by that a Brazilian poet, Tiago de Melo. After we spoke on Cimarron a few days ago, I found that small speech that Tiago de Melo delivered during the opening ceremony of the monument to the runaway slave in the Cuba, in the eastern part of Cuba. And he says, after I read Cimarron 30 years ago, I realized that the Cimarron is deeply in the soul of the whole Cuban people. And I think that this is the key to start approaching to the race situation in Cuba. And I was listening to Miguel when he said that the situation of the race issue in the United States is different from the situation of race in Cuba, including the historic roots. And the issue is that it is difficult in Cuba, in the Cuban case, to say or to define African descendants or African minority, because Africa is in the whole Cuban population. There is a very popular phrase in Cuba, I don't know how to say that in English, el que no tiene de Congo tiene de Carabalí. But this is it's not a joke, it's a reality for the Cuban people. And that context is in the base of the policy followed by the revolution in the to address the race issue. That is why I think that even if having in mind that in Cuba, as in all the American countries who had slaves brought from Africa. Nowadays, there are still things to improve in the issue of race. But we can be proud when we see that the Cuban Revolution policy, inclusive, wide, I don't know how many adjectives I can provide, but had been equal for every person, every Cuban citizen. Of course, there are economic factors, cultural factors that define some issues that still remain on the when we approach the race issue in Cuba. But I feel very proud on the situation in Cuba today, because the revolution have worked very hard to include, all the sectors of the Cuban population in all the to achieve the social justice equal, and that this is a question, a factor that I considered very important in the race issue. But I repeat that the main concept to see, to study the race issue in Cuba is to realize that there is no African minority in Cuba, because Africa is part of our nationality. That's the point. Thank you.
In the back there with the red cap, yeah, first. And then Andres, and then the, yeah, you.
So thank you for that presentation. My name is. Thank you for that presentation. My name is Nino Brown. I'm with the Party for Socialism and Liberation. I have the book Race in Cuba. I think it was, you know, a pretty good book. In the United States, my question is really about like the role of Marxism Leninism in trying to understand some of these problems in Cuba. You know, because some have said that in the United States that black people exist as a nation within a nation in the United States. It probably is not the same thing in Cuba, right? So how does that affect, you know, the analysis and strategy, you know, for building, to deepening your revolution, but also, you know, for building a revolution in the United States? Because from my perspective, you're not going to get to socialism without going through black liberation. But in Cuba, you already have socialism, so what is the role of black liberation or various forms of Pan-Africanism and black nationalism in Cuba, which is already a socialist state? One question?
Yeah.
One question?
Okay. I will answer that in very short way. In a very short state. Blacks in Cuba are not a nation within a nation. We are one whole nation with integration, but not integration to capitalism, integration to a humanistic socialism that places blacks in the same level of the rest of the population, whether you are dark or mulatto or white. That is why Fernando Ortiz in 1930 said Cuba without blacks would not be Cuba. We can also add Cuba without Spaniards or the legacy of Spain would not be Cuba. Thanks God we have learned
even with discrimination and with difficulties, to integrate one whole society as an identical corpus. You get it? So, some people say New York is a melting pot. Yeah, I know. I've lived here. I know it's a melting pot. But Cuba is a melting pot, a real melting pot. I mean, who discriminates in Cuba? People with still a very backward mentality of petit bourgeoisie. But no one with a consciousness of socialism and of nationalism in a wide scope would discriminate in Cuba. That won't be accepted. So that's the answer to your first question. In your question, let me just, since I am already talking, I don't want to lose the enthusiasm. And my flesh is hot now. And he said something, I don't want to go over that and forget, because it's very important. He spoke about Fidel. When I was 20 years old, or 21, I heard the first speech of Fidel talking to the so-called intellectuals, the artists and writers, really. Because if you speak about intellectuals, you have to add, to include medical doctors, physicians, engineers. But he specifically spoke to a crowd of artists and writers of different trends, you know. At that time, imagine 1961, what was Cuba? Cuba was a big mess. There were Marxists on one side, anti-Marxists, Catholics, Protestants, people with no political feelings, right? No political dreams, nothing. And the revolution began and started to put some energy and new ideas in the Cuban population. And in that speech, Fidel began to speak about racism and the idea of fighting against that issue as a priority. And until his last breath, he was conscious about that, and we consider that this is still a priority. We don't have racism as the other countries in Latin America, but we still have some remnants, you know, of that feeling, because that feeling is in the subjectivity and the mentality of people. It's very difficult to eradicate that, to brush away with that. Very difficult. And we're working very hard in that field. But Fidel also, in one of his interviews in early 60s, I think probably in 1962, spoke about these men and women who were ex-slaves and who were willing to start to learn and write because they were illiterate. Imagine, they were illiterate. The character of my book, Esteban Montejo, Cimarrón, knew how to write his name and to read some, let's say, breaking news with big letters in the newspaper. Never read a book, but he had such a wisdom. He had such a wonderful memory, and he carried in the deepest of his soul such a treasure of treasure of ideas and such a wonderful cosmogony, ideological cosmogony, which is another kind of rationalism, because what the Africans brought to Cuba was not the European rationalism, was the subjective rationalism that also helps to build a society. Because sometimes racists say what Africans brought is pure poetic ideas. Ah, oh, wait a minute, poetic ideas with a special rationalism, a rationalism that helped to construct, to build up a society also, because it was an energy, a very profound and mysterious energy coming from history that contributed to create a new society. Very strongly. I would say black people in Cuba who were illiterate were creating such an impulse to the revolution stronger than any other group of people in the country, because they had dreams which were different from white bourgeois people. This is very difficult. This deserves a special conference. But when Dr. August Nims spoke about the inspiration that I probably received from Fidel, when Fidel spoke about these women and men that were illiterate and that no one really paid attention to them. Incredible. Our society began mended by the Platt Amendment. Okay? And where was the imperialism raised? Where is the real cradle of imperialism? It was in Cuba in 1898, when they took over the Cuban people, and they took over Puerto Rico, and they took over the Philippines. That's the beginning of imperialism in this country. And to my, in my opinion, I was always very, very inspired and motivated by Fidel's words about these black men and women. And I asked to myself, how come during this large period of from 1898 to 1959, no one really, people studied slavery with statistics, with a lot of documentation, but no one stopped to talk to an African origin woman or man. So I think it was those words of Fidel when he said, take a look at these people. It's important to write the story, the life story of these people who suffered slavery and who are still here in Cuba, survived, because we had slaves until 1964, 65. Slaves. Can you imagine that I met a man who was a slave and he told me the story of his life? And one day he said to me, I didn't meet my parents, as I said here, because I didn't have a chance to talk to them. They segregated me to another place, to the nursery, and from that day on, I never heard anything about my parents. That is terrible. For a man my age, 21, 22, or 23 years old, white, blue-eyed, I was really inspired. I said, someone has to sit down and study and write the story life of this man. And that's what I did. I was studying anthropology at the Academy of Sciences, at the Institute of Anthropology. And I said, I'm going to put apart this research by myself. So I did this hiding from my agenda, from the official agenda I had in the Institute of Anthropology. I began to interview this man. I went there with a big tape recorder that weighed 35 pounds in a bus, and every week getting stories and stories and collecting and recreating those stories, because the man was marvelous, but he didn't have the words of a writer. So it's true. Fidel inspired me for that, because I always say Fidel is an iluminado, the man with a great illumination. And he set up that the light he shed over the people to my heart. And that is the reason why I began to write The Runaway Slave, Cimarrón, that has already 71 editions in the United States, 8. And one of the ones I like the most is the one made by Mamiri Baraka.
Oh, yeah.
I think I'm going to meet Amina Baraka tomorrow, no?
Okay.
He's tonight, my friend. Yeah. Tonight. Oh, he's my friend. So that's
She's here.
No, but I'm talking about the mayor of Newark.
Oh, Arras.
Arras is my friend. He went to visit us at the Writers and Artists Union. We have groups every week of people from the States. You know that, my friends. You know that. He's from New Jersey. from New Jersey and Havana, that we at the Writers and Artists Union always welcome Afro-Americans and Americans from different areas and universities.
Sir, I don't want to be insulting, but I think you should sit down.
Thank you.
I'd like to hear from this black woman.
Yes, yes, of course, yes.
Well,
You're right.
I'm trying to be patient.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to be personally insulting. This is not my style, but yeah. I really thought that...
Some most thought he had a good story to tell, though.
I understand, but I understand that part of the story is what people who experience them to say. Mm-hmm. And as a man, I cannot tell the story of a woman. Mm-hmm. And I apologize forever for doing so.
Yeah, okay,
I just couldn't control it anymore, and I didn't know how else to do it.
Okay.
So,
okay. Janela.
Okay, my name is Janela Gonzalez Gonzalez. I'm from Cuba. As I just told you, I only been 2 days here. But it's a really good opportunity to talk about you, about my experience. It's a pleasure, but to hear about him is a really good opportunity to learn everybody here. So to talk about the woman here in Cuba is a really great opportunity to defend all our system. Something important that when you're talking about Cuba and the Erasmus in Cuba, you have to analyze that Cuba is like a big soup, you know? Like ajiaco, we call ajiaco. It's like everybody putting different elements there, and everybody has to be together in the same oil, you know? So that's Cuba. So we can talk about the Spaniards, about black, about, because we have to talk about Italian, about Chinese person, about Spanish, about different people around the world that they came to Cuba to make our history, to make our tradition. So when we're talking about the Erasmus, we can't compare. We have to analyze the context. That's what I explained to all my group that they're going to the Cuban Institute of Friendship with the people when they ask this kind of question. Of course, it's not an institution problem, you know. I feel like a very quiet in my country. I have the opportunity to study in the same level like everybody here, everybody there in Cuba. I have the opportunity to go to university to teach in special need education to the babies that they have handicapped and their mental problems. And at the same time, I get to have the opportunity to have the master's degree, you know, I don't have to pay anything. It's not to be like a difference because I'm a black woman. It's not to make difference because that. I have the same opportunity. I have the same possibility. It's just to depend on me because I want to improve myself. I want to be better with my society. So see, that's so important of the Cuban woman in world right now. And something that we have to analyze is important and why we are here. Because some of the subversive acts from the government from the United States, they want to make this kind of discussion, you know, they want to make this to divide when we analyze about black Cuban and Afro-Cuban person about that. We are the same thing. We are Cubans. Not matter if you are white, yellow, blue, red, that's what I'm talking about, my baby. And something that we have to care of is to continue the education of the new generations, because that's so important, and that's why we need you to the solidarity movement, to protect our history, to protect our solidarity. But especially, our main objective in Cuba is to defend our human beings.
Interesting things that happened to me when I started encountering Cubans maybe about 20 years ago was the question oftentimes, why do you all refer to African Americans? Why do you call yourselves African Americans? Why aren't you just Americans? And I found the question very intriguing, and I just took it for granted. But I began to realize this is exactly within Cuba, because black Cubans have a sense of being Cuban first. And the reason for that, in my opinion, I think, is because of the revolutionary process going back in time.
That's right.
There's a sense of ownership of the nation. It's exactly because of the two wars of independence. The sense of ownership of the nation. And you really get a sense of this when you go to Santiago. If you're in Santiago and you start walking down the equivalent of Independence and Constitutional Avenue, and you start seeing a lot of statues. And the closer you get to the statues, you realize there are half of them are black generals. Yeah. I didn't realize Moncada Barracks. Right. Moncada was black. In Havana, Quintin Bandera. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you, so there's a sense of ownership in the nation that African Americans, at least my generation, maybe the Obama generation has this sense of ownership. But my generation, no, we didn't have a sense that this was our country. When Malcolm said, "I'm not an American, I'm a victim of Americanism," that was my sentiment. So it's a big difference, and I think it made a big difference in understanding 1959, because the working class in Cuba was not segregated racially the way the working class in the United States. They could carry out a socialist project. We couldn't do that. Our fight was to overthrow the divisions within the working class, the Jim Crow divisions. All right, Andres, and then here, Andres first.
Andres Gomez. I want to address what you said, Professor. In regards to the sending of remittances that Miguel mentioned as well. Remember this, and no one seems to realize this. Very few blacks, Cubans, came to the United States after 59. Very few in terms of the thousands of us that have come after 59. Very few were part of the emigration process to the United States. Remember that we have to go into specifics of the specific periods of migration since 1959. But through the 60s and the 70s, most families of those who had left at the earliest 60s came to the United States. And most of them were white, or whiter than the rest of the Cuban population. I think whiter will be more true. Now, 1980 brought more blacks, or less white Cubans, to the United States. But since then, most of those who had left Cuba illegally, because legally it's very hard, because the United States will not give you the visa. But illegally, they were not blacks. Blacks remain. So when those that of us who were here after 1980 started sending remittances because we were able to travel to Cuba for the first time since the beginning of the 60s, we took our money with us. We didn't need the United States government to give us permission to send remittances. Most of the money that is sent to Cuba, even now, to families or friends, are taken by other people traveling to Cuba, not through official remittances. Mm-hmm. Although, in the last few years, official remittances have arisen. But most of them are not for blacks, because blacks were not here to start with, to send remittances. And in regards to your question, whether the purpose of the Clinton administration was to foment division, that could have been a result of the process. But it was really the needs of those of us who were here to be able to send their relatives in Cuba the money. That's why the Clinton administration decided to allow that to happen. Okay?
Yes.
I want to thank you, Miguel, for your brilliant talk as usual, because you're always very brilliant with your insights. My name is Ben Jones. I've been going to Cuba since 1977. I've been there 76 times, and I think I'm an authority on Cuba in terms of my experience. And one of the things that I've learned each time as I go there, that I say to myself, Ben, I have to see Cubans the way they see themselves. But at the same time, and that I also can't go there as an African American and just want them to see things true only from my eyes. But I think where we go wrong in the conversation, we have to see both each other's side. We have to see each other's side. And I can tell you that discrimination, racism in Cuba is alive. is alive, because I can tell you many of my friends who are black Cubans from all different levels, the conversation some of them have with me that maybe they don't have with officials. So I'm a revolutionary, I'm in full support of the revolution, but we have to have that conversation, and I think Miguel points that out in his talk. As long as we want to be in denial, and it's wonderful that you're here as a black woman, but that still doesn't, I stay in Cerro, and each time I go to Cerro, it gets blacker and blacker and blacker, and poor. So we have to have that discussion, because we only allow this imperialist country to use this against Cuba, and we all want to fight Cuba. So it's not about one side or the other, it's we have to have the conversation, you know, and that African Americans cannot deny the reality of Cubans, and Cubans cannot deny the reality of the sentiment of many African Americans. Many African Americans tell me when they go to Cuba, they can sense racism right away. It might be real or unreal, but, and one of the things that, my point that I'd like to make, it all starts, as Miguel was saying, consciousness. We have to start in the elementary schools in Cuba to give them, because it's bad enough that you don't get enough understanding in the university in Havana, that you need to start with young people in the elementary school, the secondary school, the pre-universitario schools, to make this change, because it's a process. But one of the things we cannot do is we can't just see one side and not see the other side. We have to see all sides so we can, again, work in unity. Okay, thank you.
Yes, here.
Thank you. My name is Kisia Gonzalez. I'm original from Honduras, Afro-descendant, and indigenous people. And I want to thank you both for the excellent presentation. But my concern is that two things. One, revolution is very important in order to African descendant, black people, can see and can live through changes. But in order to conceptualize and to carry on these revolutions, we need to establish where we are as a black people. And my question for you two is, and put it into context, recently the United Nations has declared the African descendant decay. And I would like to see from you both, what is your perspective and how to heal the fact that coming from slavery has a deep impact and people recognizing their own humanity. And if you think that this declaration were the Universal Declaration and African descendant and the intention to include and to develop African descendant people wherever they are, it will have any impact in the more and very deep way to raise and validate our own humanity as an African descendant. How you see that?
So it's important that our government and our people recognize that we have some problem with the development here in Cuba. And even that we have a lot of the spaces, we have that kind of conversation, even with some authority in Cuba, about what happened in the TV, about what happened in the joke that Miguel Barnett said about the black people that we work on. But something important is that we organize different events about the Afro-Descendants Day, because the UNESCO decided that all this descent is going to be about that. But here in Cuba, we have even the religion organization, the community projects, where when you go to Cuba, you can see that in that community. How the community projects, they work in this kind of the areas, you know, but more than that, they're working about our culture. Because something important is, we can never forget our history. And when we're talking about history, we have to talk about slave hold here in Cuba. We have to talk about black leaders in Cuba. We have to talk about the black men that they was a fighter in the independent war. So that's something important that we have here in Cuba. We defend that, even that we have problems. something important is that we recognize that, you know. So that's one of the main objectives. And of course, we are different in the union of the writers and artists. They have the space that is the commission of José Antonio Aponte, that they talk about all these activities, and they talk about the problems, about the racism that are here in Cuba. So we don't say, no, we don't want to talk about that, no. We're talking about that because the main thing is our government recognize that we have the problems, and we have to figure out how we can work in together. We are not a perfect system. We are not a perfect country. Something important is that we recognize all the problems that we have, and we're working on it.
We have to.
I want to answer that. I don't believe in declarations. No, I don't believe in declarations. I believe in actions, affirmative actions, in education and in ways to improve the culture of people, and that's what we are doing in Cuba.
It's 3:55, and we've got workshops beginning in. No, it's 3:55. We don't want to push.
Considering
push
what
things
happened,
back.
I'd like to say a few words before I go.
Phil,
allow me. Yes.
Phil.
Okay. First, I apologize to the professor and to everybody, but I apologize in the sense that I don't disrespect people. This has never happened to me. However, I felt I was in a situation, and maybe you're talking about age, I was in sensitivity, and I don't think we have to say how much we support Cuba. I'm assuming we're all here because we support Cuba. As I'm getting older and I'm experiencing more, I realize that what is very important is not just how you're trying, but for me, what's important also is that you involve those implicated. As a man, I can come with all the good intentions in the world, and I can say the best thing, and then finally, I sit down and some woman told me, well, actually, you're actually falling short of certain things. So in spite, and personally, I have a personal stake as a Haitian, where race is an issue. I'm hoping for a day when my country can be in a position of Cuba. And I'm trying to understand and learn from that experience, because that is definitely has been a problem in the history of my country and will be in the future. So what I was sensing there, and when I say that I wanted to hear from her, it's not because every idea she has is superior to his, because she's a black woman. It's just that she's in a unique position. And I felt that there was maybe a lack of understanding, and I want to apologize of that particular relationship. I mean, I've been in Cuba where somebody approached me and he tells me, you know, us mulattoes have to stick together. Now, that was a long time ago. Now I would have asked what that meant so I could understand more. I have a Haitian friend of mine who's a director of an organization, and she goes with another woman who's a professional, and they're very like New York, you know, she has very short hair, and she's wearing short pants. She goes to a museum, and she's approached by a security guy, and at the end of it is that she's insulted. And we're talking about respect. And I guess what I was saying to say is that we have to realize that good intentions are not enough to get good results.